Like all men in Babylon, I have been a proconsul. Like all, a slave. I have also known omnipotence, opprobrium, jail. Look, the index finger of my right hand is missing. Look again. Through this rent in my cape, you can see a ruddy tattoo on my belly. It is the second symbol, Beth. This letter, on nights of full moon, gives me power over men whose mark is Gimel. But it also subordinates me to those marked Aleph, who on moonless nights owe obedience to those marked Gimel. In a cellar at dawn, I have severed the jugular vein of sacred bulls against a black rock. During one lunar year, I have been declared invisible. I shrieked and was not heard. I stole my bread and was not decapitated. I have known what the Greeks did not, uncertainty. In a bronze chamber, faced with the silent handkerchief of a strangler, hope has been faithful to me. In the river of delights, panic has not failed me. Heraclitus of Pontica admiringly relates that Pythagoras recalled having been Pyro, and before that, Euphorbus, and before that, some other mortal. In order to recall analogous vicissitudes, I do not need to have recourse to death, nor even to imposture. I owe this almost atrocious variety to an institution which other republics know nothing about, or which operates among them imperfectly and in secret, the lottery. I have not delved into its history. I do not know that the wizards have been unable to come to any agreement. Of its powerful designs, I know what a man not versed in astrology might know of the moon. I come from a vertiginous country where the lottery forms a principal part of reality. Until this very day, I have thought about all this as little as I have about the behavior of the indecipherable gods or about the beating of my own heart. Now, far from Babylon and its beloved customs, I think of the lottery with some astonishment and ponder the blasphemous conjectures murmured by men in the shadows at twilight. My father related that anciently, a matter of centuries, of years, the lottery in Babylon was a game of plebeian character. He said, I do not know with what degree of truth, that barbers gave rectangular bits of bone or decorated parchment in exchange for copper coins. A drawing of the lottery was held in the middle of the day. The winners received, without further corroboration from chance, silver minted coins. The procedure, as you see, was elemental. Naturally, these lotteries failed. Their moral virtue was nil. They did not appeal to all the faculties of men, only to their hope. In the face of public indifference, the merchants who established these venal lotteries began to lose money. Someone attempted to introduce a slight reform, the interpolation of a certain small number of adverse outcomes among the favored numbers. By means of this reform, the purchasers of numbered rectangles stood the double chance of winning a sum or of paying a fine often considerable in size. This slight danger, for each 30 favored numbers, there would be one adverse number, awoke, as was only natural, the public's interest. The Babylonians gave themselves up to the game. Anyone who did not acquire lots was looked upon as pusillanimous, mean-spirited. In time, this disdain multiplied. The person who did not play was despised, but the losers who paid the fine were also scorned. The company, thus it began to be known at that time, was forced to take measures to protect the winners, who could not collect their prizes unless nearly the entire amount of the fines was already collected. The company brought suit against the losers. The judge condemned them to pay the original fine plus costs or to spend a number of days in jail. Every loser chose jail so as to defraud the company. It was from this initial bravado of a few men that the all-powerful position of the company, its ecclesiastical, metaphysical strength, was derived. A short while later, the reports on the drawings omitted any enumeration of fines and limited themselves to publishing the jail sentences corresponding to each adverse number. This laconism, also unnoticed at the time, became of capital importance. It constituted the first appearance in the lottery of non-pecuniary elements. Its success was great. Pushed to such a measure by the players, the company found itself forced to increase its adverse numbers. No one can deny that the people of Babylonia are highly devoted to logic, even to symmetry. It struck them as incoherent that the fortunate numbers should be computed in round figures of money while the unfortunate should be figured in terms of days and nights in jail. Some moralists argued that the possession of money does not determine happiness, and that other forms of fortune are perhaps more immediate. There was another source of restlessness in the lower depths. The members of the sacerdotal college multiplied the stakes and plumbed the vicissitudes of terror and hope. The poor, with reasonable or inevitable envy, saw themselves excluded from this notoriously delicious exhilaration. The just anxiety of all, poor and rich alike, to participate equally in the lottery, inspired an indignant agitation, the memory of which the years have not erased. Certain obstinate souls did not comprehend, or pretended not to comprehend, that a new order had come, a necessary historical stage. A slave stole a crimson ticket, a ticket which earned him the right to have his tongue burned in the next drawing. The criminal code fixed the same penalty for the theft of a ticket. A number of Babylonians argued that he deserved a red-hot poker by virtue of the theft. Others, more magnanimous, held that the public executioner should apply the penalty of the lottery, since chance had so determined. Disturbances broke out. There was a lamentable shedding of blood, but the people of Babylon imposed their will, at last, over the opposition of the rich. That is, the people fully achieved their magnanimous ends. In the first place, it made the company accept complete public power. This unification was necessary, given the vastness and complexity of the new operations. In the second place, it forced the lottery to be secret, free, and general. The sale of tickets for money was abolished. Once initiated into the mysteries of Bell, every free man automatically participated in the sacred drawings of lots, which were carried out in the labyrinths of the gods every 70 nights, and which determined every man's fate until the next exercise. The consequences were incalculable. A happy drawing might motivate his elevation to the council of wizards, or his condemnation to the custody of an enemy, notorious or intimate, or to find in the peaceful shadows of a room the woman who had begun to disquiet him or whom he had never expected to see again. An adverse drawing might mean mutilation, a varied infamy, death, sometimes a single event, the tavern killing of C, the mysterious glorification of B, might be the brilliant result of 30 or 40 drawings. But it must be recalled that the individuals of the company were and are all-powerful and astute as well. In many cases, the knowledge that certain joys were the simple doing of chance might have detracted from their excellence. To avoid this inconvenience, the company's agents made use of suggestion and magic. Their moves, their management, were secret. In the investigation of people's intimate hopes and intimate terrors, they made use of astrologers and spies. There were certain stone lions. There was a sacred privy called Quafka. There were fissures in a dusty aqueduct which, according to general opinion, led to the company. Malign or benevolent people deposited accusations in these cracks. The denunciations were incorporated into an alphabetical archive of variable veracity. Incredibly enough, there were still complaints. The company, with its habitual discretion, did not reply directly. It preferred to scribble a brief argument, which now figures among sacred scriptures, in the debris of a mask factory. The doctrinal piece of literature observed that the lottery is an interpolation of chance into the order of the world, and that to accept errors is not to contradict fate, but merely to corroborate it. It also observed that those lions and that sacred recipient, though not unauthorized by the company, which did not renounce the right to consult them, functioned without official guarantee. This declaration pacified the public unease. It also produced other effects, not foreseen by the author. It deeply modified the spirit and operations of the company. I have little time left to tell what I know. We have been warned that the ship is ready to sail, but I will attempt to explain it. Improbable as it may be, no one had until then attempted to set up a general theory of games. A Babylonian is not highly speculative. He reverses the judgments of fate. He hands his life over to them. He places his hopes, his panic, terror in them. But it never occurs to him to investigate their labyrinthian laws, nor the giratory spheres which disclose them. Nevertheless, the unofficial declaration which I have mentioned inspired many discussions of a juridico-mathematical nature. From one of these discussions was born the following conjecture. If the lottery is an intensification of chance, a periodic infusion of chaos into the cosmos, would it not be desirable for chance to intervene at all stages of the lottery and not merely in the drawing? Is it not ridiculous for chance to dictate the death of someone while the circumstances of his death, its silent reserve or publicity, the time limit of 1 hour or 1 century, should remain immune to hazard? These eminently just scruples finally provoked a considerable reform, whose complexities, intensified by the practice of centuries, are not understood except by a handful of specialists, but which I will attempt to summarize, even if only in a symbolic manner. Let us imagine a first drawing, which eventuates in a sentence of death against some individual. To carry out the sentence, another drawing is set up, and this drawing proposes, let us say, 9 possible executioners. Of these executioners, 4 can initiate a third drawing, which will reveal the name of the actual executioner. 2 others can replace the adverse order with the fortunate order, the finding of a treasure, let us say. Another may exacerbate the death sentence, that is, make it infamous or enrich it with torture. Still others may refuse to carry it out. Such is the symbolic scheme. In reality, the number of drawings is infinite. No decision is final, all diverge into others. The ignorant suppose that an infinite number of drawings requires an infinite amount of time. In reality, it is quite enough that time be infinitely subdivisible, as is the case in the most famous parable of the tortoise and the hare. This infinitude harmonizes in an admirable manner with the sinuous numbers of chance and of the celestial archetype of the lottery, adored by the Platonists. A certain distorted echo of our ritual seems to have resounded along the Tiber. Aelius Lampridius, in his Life of Antoninus Heliogabalus, tells of how this emperor wrote down the lot of his guests on seashells so that one would receive 10 pounds of gold and another 10 flies, 10 dormice, 10 bears. It is only right to remark that Heliogabalus was educated in Asia Minor among the priests of the eponymous god. There are also impersonal drawings of undefined purpose. One drawing will decree that a sapphire from Taprobane be thrown into the waters of the Euphrates, another that a bird be released from a tower roof, another that a grain of sand be withdrawn or added to the innumerable grains on a beach. The consequences sometimes are terrifying. Under the beneficent influence of the company, our customs have become thoroughly impregnated with chance. The buyer of a dozen amphoras of Damascus wine will not be surprised if one of them contains a talisman or a viper. The scribe who draws up a contract scarcely ever fails to introduce some erroneous datum. I myself, in making this hasty declaration, have falsified or invented some grandeur, some atrocity, perhaps, too, a certain mysterious monotony. Our historians, the most discerning in the world, have invented a method for correcting chance. It is well known that the operations of this method are, in general, trustworthy, although naturally they are not divulged without a measure of deceit. In any case, there is nothing so contaminated with fiction as the history of the company. A paleographic document unearthed in a temple may well be the work of yesterday's drawing or that of one lasting a century. No book is ever published without some variant in each copy. Scribes take a secret oath to omit, interpolate, vary. The company, with divine modesty, eludes all publicity. Its agents, as is only natural, are secret. The orders which it is continually sending out do not differ from those lavishly issued by impostors. Besides, who can ever boast of being a mere impostor? The inebriate who impoverishes an absurd mandate, the dreamer who suddenly awakes to choke the woman who lies at his side to death, do they not both, perhaps, carry out a secret decision by the company? This silent functioning, comparable to that of God, gives rise to all manner of conjectures. One of them, for instance, abominably insinuates that the company is eternal and that it will last until the last night of the world, when the last God annihilates the cosmos. Still another conjecture declares that the company is omnipotent, but that it exerts its influence only in the most minute matters, in a bird's cry, in the shades of rust and the hues of dust, in the catnaps of dawn. There is one conjecture spoken from the mouths of masked heresiarchs to the effect that the company has never existed and never will. A conjecture no less vile argues that it is indifferently inconsequential to affirm or deny the reality of the shadowy corporation, because Babylon is nothing but an infinite game of chance.